Welcome back. We will now hear a talk about Bareus from Mike Ausendorf.
Yeah. Hello, so my name is Mike Ausendorf from Bareus. I'm one of the co-founder of the project and the company. And today I want to talk about integration of Bareus into the common tool chains that you usually have in larger deployments. So, but I will start with a short introduction and an overview. What is Bareus? What can it do? What is new? And then we will have a look around the tool chains that there are that people usually use. And assuming that the VPN connection is working, I can show you a little bit of a live demo of a new Graphite and Grafana interface that we have built for Bareus. So, and if the VPN does not work, I have a few slides with graphs, so let's see. Okay, so some words about Bareus. It is a fork of the Bacula.org project. Marco van Wiering was one of the topmost contributors to Bacula, and he has started in 2010 to collect patches that didn't make it into Bacula and implemented own ideas. And we made the first release of Bareus in 2013. I don't want to comment a lot on why we did this. The basic idea was we wanted to implement our own ideas, speed up development, and we really wanted to make sure that the whole project stays completely open source. And so since 2013, when we had the first release, we had almost one major release every year since then. So, I mean, you're all here because you love open source and you know why to use it. But I think with backup, there's one special point. So imagine you were buying a new vault in your safe to store your old school valuables, and the vendor says, okay, but I take the key, and whenever you want to access your valuables, you have to see if you've paid your subscription and your license fees, and otherwise you won't get the key. So of course, nobody would buy such a vault, but there are similar cases in the backup software industry. So if you watch very carefully at some of the subscription terms, then you find terms that say, if you don't buy a subscription renewal after a year or so, then you have to delete the software. And what does it mean? If you have to delete your backup software, you can't restore your data. So that is pretty much the same as a vault vendor keeping the key. So you don't want to have that. You want to have open source backup software. And who of you now see Future of Open Source survey? Anybody has taken place? It's a yearly survey made by Black Duck, an American company, and yesterday they've presented the results from this year's survey. There were about 1,400 participants, and I just took one slide because I said it was interesting. People were asked, what are the competitive features of open source compared to closed source software? And this year, the first time that number one was freedom from vendor lock-in was a major reason to choose open source over other solutions. And this particularly applies to backup. But now back to our issue. So who of you is using Bareus? Okay, quite some. Who is using Bacula? Okay, so most of you know what Bareus is capable of, so I will just say a few words. So Bareus offers all features that you usually would expect from an ordinary network backup tool. So that means we have multi-platform support, we have packages for almost all Linux distributions, for Windows, for macOS, for Unix. You can buy it or build it if you need it for another Unix version that there might be no packages available. Then usually you don't want to trigger your backup jobs manually, but you have a schedule, so we have all the usual stuff like full differential incremental backup, whatever you support, whatever you require. All the backup metadata is stored in an SQL database, which we call catalog, and we usually use Postgres or MySQL for that. And then you can, of course, do restores, which is, well, the more important part, using a command line interface or a web GUI. I can show you later a little bit of the state of the web GUI if you're interested in. So, and then, of course, you can encrypt data. You can encrypt the data on the client with individual keys per client. Of course, then you have to make your users take care of their keys. But you can also add a master key and keep this. And in case the client or the end user loses his key, you can still use a master key to decrypt. apart from the data encryption itself, you can optionally, additionally, or alternatively just encrypt the transport. So using TLS, you can encrypt any transports going between the clients and the backup server. We have access control lists, so we can control who has access to which kind of data from which clients and so on. And of course, we backup to disks, to tape libraries, to cloud, whatever people expect. And we have a scripting interface for pre and post jobs, for plugins, so at almost every point in the backup process, you can plug in your Python scripts and change the process in whatever way you want to do that. So one word about the architecture. So the central is a Bareos server, which technically consists of three components. One component is called the director. That is a component that controls everything, where everything is configured, where the schedule is, and the director knows about everything that happens. And we have the database. And we have here a component that we call storage daemon. That is a daemon that controls and communicates with the media where we write the backups to, so disk, tapes, and so on. On most installations, these three components reside on one server, but of course you can split it for whatever reason. Yeah, and then we can also backup into the cloud, so we have native connectors to Gluster and Ceph. But on the other hand, we can also backup the cloud itself. So if you have important data in your Ceph storage, then we have native Ceph clients that can take the data out, the block data, and write it to tape and to bring it to some other place or whatever. So, and then of course we support clients on Windows, on Mac, on Linux. We have a VMware plugin that can backup snapshots and can do this incrementally using the changed block tracking feature. And then there is a dedicated plugin for Microsoft SQL Server, which allows point-in-time recovery. And we spent some development effort on NDMP so that you can directly get the data using the NDMP protocol from your NetApp or other storages that support these protocols. So this is just a rough overview, because we will have some of the terms later, like director as the controlling instance of Bareos. Any questions until now? Okay. So forking a project is one thing, but developing a new one out of it is another thing. So we've really implemented a lot of new features. And one thing that we've started was the packaging process. So we have a fully automated packaging process using an own instance of SUSE's open build server. Whoever needs to build packages from time to time for several distributions should have a look at it. It's really great. So from one single point of source from GitHub, which we automatically pull into our build system, we build packages for all these distributions, including Windows as a cross-compile. So some new features that came into the last version, which was published at the Open Source Backup Conference last year. So the VMware plugin is pretty new. The web UI was launched the first time, which also has a Restore browser. I can show you later how you can select files for Restore using the web UI. Then we have a new or refurbished Director API, which becomes essential for our talk here, because that's the kind of point where you can interact and automatically do things with Bareos. Then one feature is called Secure Arrays, which technically is quite simple. It only means that you can, instead of a simple remove used for temporary files or for spool files, configure a command that securely erases a file. But this quite simple technical thing is important for banks or financial institutes who have to comply with one of these abbreviations, standards there, like SOX or things like that. But there are some people asking for that kind of stuff. Yeah, then I said we support, since the last version, backup of Ceph and cluster storages. We have new plugins for MySQL, which basically are using MySQL dump. But in the near future, we will have also Percona extra backup plugin, so that you can make your plugins or your backups using Percona and store the data using Bareos. Then there are iSinger plugins. We have a new plugin to back up LDAP trees, which also allows the restore of single objects from your LDAP tree. So if some administrators occasionally have deleted a subtree or the whole tree, then you can simply restore it from the backup. And the full list is there. Reference is much longer than this, but I just wanted to give you a short overview. So we're actually working on the next version called 16.x. Some things here on the list have already done. Some were sponsored developments, like the first one, director reload enhancements. That is especially important if you do scripting around Pareo. So if you change configurations by scripts, then you have to issue the command reload director to make the director reload its configuration. And there was a limitation, so after some 1,000 calls, there was a memory leak, or memory was not freed, but that problem is now solved, so you can do it more or less eternally. Then there's one feature that is interested in several environments called client-initiated backups. Usually the way is that the director has a schedule and says, okay, now it's time to backup this laptop. Or what if the laptop is not present? Okay, you can tell the director, retry after X hours again. But sometimes you may have customers or users in other network segments where you may be not allowed to connect, to initiate a connection from the director to the client. And with client-initiated backups, we have a way that the client, whenever it has a network connection, will try to get a connection to its director and will ask, hey, is there something to do for me? Shall I do a backup or so? And that's one of the new features that's already done in this next release. Yeah, NDMP is an ongoing issue, Percona already mentioned, so that's what we're working on. We're also working on improving the web UI so that we now can do storage and media handling, that we can display for all the clients, are they up to date with the latest Pareo software, and we will import graphics created by Grafana, which we will see later, and multi-language support, so there's you can switch language to German, for example. So then there's one thing we will talk about later more in detail. From an administrator's point of view, one of the most common tasks is how to add a client to the backup. And we have improved this process so that it can be done with a one-line command. Another thing where we are working on is TLS authentication with PAM, so that we are able to use a PAM or LDAP backend to authenticate administrators or users, so that makes it much easier for administration purposes. The VMware plugin now is also capable to restore not only to the originating VM, but you can also say, I have this backup from this machine, and I want to restore it to a separate VMDK file, and then you can do whatever you want to do with this VMDK file. Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization is on the roadmap, but I don't think it will be ready this year. So this is a restore browser. In future versions will be also possible to limit the number of menu items so that we have a kind of self-service portal for end users who can connect to the web browser, log in with their credentials, and then see for the configured clients the data, and so that makes it much easier. Also from administrators, people won't have to call in, hello, please restore this or that file. They can just go to the web browser and do it themselves. Anyone of you knows OpenHub? Used to be Olo in the past. That is an automatic platform that analyzes open source projects from GitHub and other sources and makes all kinds of statistics. It's a pretty good source of information if you want to see what is an open source project about. Are there a lot of people working on it? How's progress? How many commits? And so on. Yeah, and they rate us as the top, below the top 2% by team size of all open source projects on GitHub, which means high activity, this little icon there. But it's a really good source of information to have a look at OpenHub. So this is weekly unique visits on download.pareos.org, so including all the Debian clients looking if there is a backup. So we have like 20k per day right now, and it doubles more or less every 10 months since we've started in 2013. Some customers, backup is a cross-branch stuff, so everyone needs it. It's an infrastructure thing, so Bavarian State Archives is one. We have a lot of universities, Max Planck Institutes, banks, and so on. One word about free software and subscription. If someone wants to use Bareus, but also wants to have support, we have a model pretty much like Red Hat, so you can buy subscriptions so that you get all the patches as binary releases, which are all tested and so. But of course, everything is on GitHub by means of the source code, so it's just an add-on, like pretty much like Red Hat does. Okay, so now we come to the point of this talk. When I prepared these things, I started to sort out what would be of importance if I want to integrate Bareus in an existing data center environment where a lot of open source tools are already in use. So we will go clockwise, starting with deployment, then have a look at user management, reporting, billing, scripting, monitoring, performance analysis, log file analysis, and auditing. And of course, you see in many points there, this will be really an overview, so we won't have time to look at configuration files for all these things. So let's start with deployment. So if you want to install Bareus, there are for Linux, RPM, and Debian packages, for Windows, installer packages, which are a little bit more comfortable principle than the Linux packages, because you can specify a lot of parameters to the installation process, and this way configure most of the director or the client stuff. And there are OPSI packages. So in short, I think we don't have to talk about a lot of this. Most of you will have ways to deploy standard software packages, so this is not really an issue. So, adding a client. So, okay, first you need to deploy the client package on the client machine, which is like we said before. Alternative could be using the VMware plugin. If you want to back up a virtual machine from VMware, you could use the plugin. But of course, that's only for disaster recovery. It's not that easy to just restore a single file from a disk image that you have backupped with a plugin. So in most cases, if you want single file restore, you will want to deploy a client package on each machine. So what you have to know to configure the client are just two pieces of information. It's the name of the director, and it's a shared secret that you share with the director. So that is all just two things. So the configuration file is pretty simple. It's just 4 or 6 lines in total with all the braces and so on. Again, on Linux or Windows, you could do this with configuration files. For Windows, you could even specify those two parameters on the installer. And there's a dedicated how-to article which elaborates this a little bit more. I think that is not difficult here. On the director, you have to configure things as well. And here the minimum is what you need is a symbolic file daemon, which is the term for the client, and the network address or full qualified hostname of the client. So that's all. When you've done this, you can put it into one configuration file, put it into an include directory, which you can specify in the director configuration that there's an include directory, and then you reload the director, and then you can start to work with the client. Of course, with this minimum requirements, there are not yet any jobs defined. At this point, you could only start manual jobs. So you would need 3 or 4 lines more to define a job for this client. If you have predefined jobs, which you usually have, there are default jobs, then it's 3 lines more, and then you are done. And in most environments, people define 2 or 3 classes of clients they backup. So by means of when will the backups run, when will it be full, when will it incremental, and the retention period. So how long do you keep the full data, full backup data, and how long to keep, for example, the incremental data. And then you have these 2 or 3 classes, and then it makes it, it's really easy to add a new client to your configuration. So, I said before, we are working here on a one-line command to make it a little bit easier to add a client to the director configuration. So this is also, yeah, not a big deal. And so, because we have this flexible structure with include directories and all plain configuration files, it's not a surprise that there are quite a lot examples around and snippets in all kinds of repositories for Puppet, Chef, Ansible, or Salt. If you want to look for this, a good source of information is the website of the OSBC, the Open Source Backup Conference. So the archive goes back to 2009, and you find a lot of things there, including videos showing, for example, from last year, presentation, a live presentation, how to deploy Bareos with Salt. So there's, I think, not a big point here to integrate it well. So the B console, that is a command line interface, which you can use in most cases to control Bareos. You can start or stop jobs there manually. You can retrieve all kind of information. You can do media handling. And it's also scriptable via a standard in and standard out. So I can just give you a little insight how that looks. Just call B console. And now it should connect to the director. So this is a VM here running. And one nice thing, it has tab completion. So if I now press tab, then I get the status command. And then, for example, status director gives me some information about the director I'm connected to. There are currently no jobs running. Well, these were the last jobs, and these are the scheduled jobs, and when they are scheduled to run. So you get help on everything. And if you want to do run a job, for example, then you get also tab completion on available options here. So most people get used to it pretty fast. So, but of course, when we talk about scripting, parsing standard std out with regular expressions is no fun. So we decided to make this interface a little bit better. And we added what we called API.2 or version 2, which can optionally give everything as a JSON output back. And that's all network capable. So there's an own legacy protocol between director and B console, and BAT, which used to be a graphic interface. So we've extended this with more commands and added the JSON output functionality to make it easy, handleable by scripting language like PHP or Python. So the design goal is to keep all the logic inside the director. So for example, if we define access controllers in the director, then of course it will be automatically applied to any client, whether it's a web UI or a script. They will all depend on the same ACLs defined once in the director. And this is different to some of the web fronts being around for Bacula. They mostly tend to try to get their own logic for ACLs. So, but this is our design goal here, and we think that makes sense. So to summarize scripting, so the director API, you can use the B console via pipe. Then the director API with its JSON interface is pretty good for scripting, so our web UI uses that way, and everybody could use a PHP client class that was developed during the process of developing the web UI. There's also a Python class that makes it easy to connect to the director. We are going to add the one-line configure command. And there's also a Fuse interface. It's more a showcase for the Python class, because it's completely written in Python. But it's kind of funny, so I give you a short overview. So this is this Fuse mount here, which basically uses a Python script. So you call it, I have it. So that is the command here to make the mount with command. And then if you go to that directory where it's mounted, so a kind of virtual file system, there you find, for example, all the jobs you know, different names. So let's take, for example, this one. And then you can browse so as if it was a file system. Take the last one here. You can have a look, some information. So when did it run? You can have a look at the complete job log of that job. And you can also have a look what was backupped during this job. So here you can browse through the files that are in the backup, actually. So, but of course, the files itself are not here. They are just displayed. So otherwise, we would have to make a restore on the fly of all the data, which would be too big. So for example, if you now do a cat, it's empty. But at this point, you can trigger a restore using the a set file attribute. And then after a while, the file will be there. Unfortunately, on this demo system, this right now doesn't work. And I hadn't have the time this morning to find out. But we have another environment where it works. So this is nice for people who are used to the command line and like to browse through file systems. Okay. Yeah, this is a sample session and it shows how the backup looks, or no, not the backup, how the command output looks like if you're using the JSON version. So any command you have on the B console can be switched to give back JSON output to make it easier to handle. Okay, and there are other implementations. So the graphite collector uses this Python class. And there's also, I have to look at the time. Oh, okay, we're good in time. A little command line tool. I don't know who of you has used Tivoli or is still using it. Tivoli Storage Manager. Okay, there are one or two. There's a tool that is called DSMC, a little command line tool. We have a little tool, maybe as a showcase for the Python interface, which is called BSMC, Bareo Simple Management. And there you can do very simple things like query, schedule. So this gives you the schedule for the next job. But it can also do do a restore, so in a very simple way. Let's say we go here and we remove the file. Oh, I can show it. So cat foo, there's not much in it. And I remove it. Yes. And with this command line tool, I can restore. I can just do trigger restore for a simple file. So, which is a little bit faster than connecting to the console and browsing through all the tree. So if you're just in a directory and types a file, you get it back. And on the other hand, you can, if you have defined a proper archive job, so an archive job has usually the requirement of a very long retention period, like 100 years or so. And if you have a file that you now want to delete, but you're not sure if you need it back maybe 3 years later, and usually the normal backups tend to be only maintained or kept on the machine for a year, which is a very common retention time for a normal backup. So after a year, all files in the backup usually will be disappeared. So, but if you, on the other hand, have this kind of archive jobs for long-term archival, then with BSMC, you can just say MC archive foo, and then this file will be backed into with this archive job and stored forever. So it's just a nice thing. And if you're thinking about connecting with Python and the directory, then these are good starting points to have a look at the BSMC client. And it shows that it's really easy to connect and extend the functionality using the API. So any questions until here? Okay. So user management. Most people connect via bconsole or other clients with just one login. So you just give, in the easiest case, one password to access a director, and then whoever can connect to the director has access to all data and to all clients, which is kind of problematic, as if you are a large organization or even a small one and do proper backups, then you have all the data of a certain importance, and usually you only backup important data at one single point. And whoever can access this data has access to all important data, obviously. So there's a good reason to split responsibilities and use, for example, access control lists, so that you have, and then you can have personal logins connected with ACL. So, for example, if you have just a department, you can assign a backup administrator there who then has only rights to access the data of a group of PCs or servers, for example. Yeah, then we are working on the PAM LDAP connector, so this will be done soon. And the web UI can be used as a self-service portal for Restore. So why isn't the green circle not full? Because there's a little limitation. We found out that the ACLs work well on the backup data itself, so that's sure. But they do not work on the list of clients. So right now, someone who has access with RCLs to maybe just one machine to do restores or to see what files are actually in the backup, he can still see a list of all clients configured on the system. So, which for most people is a minor issue, but I just want to mention it here. So, but this will be fixed with the next version. So, that was user management. Then, next on our little tour through the infrastructure is reporting and billing. Now, it happens quite often that customers or users ask, oh, what do you offer for billing? We have customers here, several organizations, and how do you call it in English? Kostenstelle, cost center. And then we say, well, it depends on your organization, what you want to do. So every situation is a little bit different, but the basic point is all backup metadata is in the catalog in an SQL database, which you can query by direct database connection or via the director API. And all kind of information like how much bytes are in a backup, which backup belongs to which client, stuff like that. So you can query all the data. So if you want to set up billing on whatever measures, then you can query it. We have a little white paper about Jasper report connection, and there's also an example template. And the result here is shown, that picture on the right is on Jasper report, which in this case graphs on the upper picture the size of a full backup of a particular client, which is called Futurama FD here. So that was set up quite quickly. And the pie chart below shows the distributions on the storage part. So we call a group of storage media a pool. And in this case, the red part is the LTO4 pool, so obviously drives. So you can see here, most data belonging to this client is stored in this pool consisting of tape drives. So, and for example, the blue one, the file storage pool, that is disk storage, and this is a set of full backups that are stored on this pool. So setting this up is quite easy. You have a white paper and a template, and the database is pretty well described and documented, so if you need something, that should work. So monitoring, there are quite a lot Isinga and Nagios plugins that use bconsole or direct database access to do all kind of checks. Example, the last jobs that run, were they successful or not? So there's plenty of stuff around. Usually, most plugins of this kind that were designed for Bacula still work with Barrios also. So I'm not aware of things that have been removed from Bacula from the past. So they should work as well. So if you search for stuff around Barrios, it's sometimes a good idea to also search for plugins or tools for Bacula. And in most cases, they work. And then we have an own plugin that directly is called from the Barrios director whenever a job is run, or it can be configured. So you can configure for which job or which client you want to have this NSCA or Isinga plugin run, and that this will transmit the job status, the times That means there are several time events when a Barreiros job runs. There's a schedule time, a real start time, end time, and real end time. So we get all this information. You get the number of bytes that were on the jobs, the number of files, and the number of errors. There are ready-made packages for this plugin, and the output then looks like this. So here you see the OK line, OK. Barreiros job, Titania data is the name of the job, then has a timestamp. The job ID level in this case was differential, had zero errors, this and that number of bytes, 24 files, and was terminated successfully. And then you can set up the usual Asinga graphs here, and here you see the peaks from the monthly full backup and some differentials in between. So this is quite easy. Performance and metrics is a little bit more tricky and interesting. Okay, so this is kind of first performance information, but there are some more things that you can easily grab out of Barreiros and monitor and analyze. So a selection of available default metrics is the number of jobs actually running. We've seen that in the B console, there were none in this case. The total bytes and backup overall, or per client, per pool, that is something that you can easily grab from Barreiros. You can ask how many jobs failed over a certain period of time. And then you have for each job the information about the time it needed, and then you have the amount of data, and obviously can easily calculate the speed, the throughput that you really got for these jobs, and the number of errors. So not, it's not all of them, but just a selection. So then your users or customers or administrators say, oh, my backup with Barreiros is so slow. Okay, what you do? Well, usually I don't like to point my finger back if someone points it to me, but in about 90% of the cases, it's not Barreiros that causes speed problems, but it's the infrastructure. So network is number one, client-side, disk I/O, number two, the same, server-side I/O, sometimes also CPU limitations. So if you have an older client with a not so powerful CPU and do encryption and compression, then this might be also a limitation. So, and if you want to track this down, you need to monitor all these certain factors. And one thing that we've implemented in this regard is that we wanted to know a little bit more in detail how a job progress is. So we can now it's disabled by default, but you can easily switch it on. We can now write every n seconds, like every 30 seconds, the progress by means of how many bytes were written for, on this job and how many files were transferred. And we can do the same for the device where we write the data, because you have to analyze both. So what is slow? Is it the client delivering the data? Is it the device, maybe the disk where you write to, or the external storage, or the tape is slow? Or is it the network in between, or is it any of the components involved, like disk I/O? The problem is that all this information is stored in the catalog and the SQL database, because this can blow up your database. But for this kind of information, you can, again, configure the retention period, and if you just set it to a couple of days or a day, and then it should be okay. So, and then you get all this information, and then you can print out large lists of numbers. No, you won't do that. Of course, you want to graph it. And with a new graphite collector, we can now gather all this kind of information and send it to a graphite carbon backend if you have got it already in place. And it wouldn't be much work to adapt this script to use other backends. So it's just one line where you submit the data, and if you have OpenTSDB or whatever else, you can simply adapt it. We have also a sample Grafana dashboard, and the recommendation is clear from what I said before. If you have graphite and carbon, then it's good to also monitor all the performance data from the backup server and the backup client, like disk I/O, network I/O, and so on. And then you can make a dashboard where you see this all in one place, and then you will probably pretty much find out where the bottleneck is. So you can download this here from GitHub, and there will also be packages very soon. So this is one Grafana chart showing the total job bytes. So yeah, virtually what is in the backup by means of amount. Then we have one, this is a job statistics where you see for particular jobs how long it takes to write the data. So I see the legend was, a part of it was lost when making the picture, but each of the line represents one job. So if you take the one from the very left, the yellow one, that was a small job, like 960 megabytes, and it went pretty fast. So that is how it should be. More interesting is the green one, which has the long horizontal line here. That looks interesting, but it's nothing to concern about, because usually it means for some reason the Barreos took some time after everything was written to disk to do some cleanup, to write stuff into databases. This may take some time, but it doesn't really slow down your backup, because the backup is on disk and everything went over network until that point. The next one, the orange one here, also looks pretty usual. What's more interesting is the last one here, which goes to the right, because it really starts like fast, like the others, and then for some reason slows down. Not completely, so it indicates it is running, but here it would be nice to have a deeper look what's going on here. Is it network at that time, or is something happening on the client which slows it down? So this may then give you hints where to look. And the next graph consolidates all the data it has here. So here's every job graph, and this one sums it all up and then makes per second calculation. That's here one of the Grafana options that you have, that you can make a speed calculation out of data. And there you can see where it was overall a lot of data transmitting and where not. If you're wondering why here is Baculadir, that is a symbolic name of our director, and it was migrated from Bacula 4 years ago, but we were too lazy to change the name. In fact, that it's not easy, so we have to touch a lot of databases, and we want to keep it because we want to see what happens if you update a server over several years. So that's why it's still there. And it also shows how the metrics are built. So the Barreos Graphite Collector script takes as first part of the name Barreos, and then the symbolic name of the director, and then in this case it has clients, and the ASUS Max takes the data from all clients that you find in the database, then look there for jobs, again take all jobs, and then the job bytes, and sum all that series up, and then makes a per second calculation. So this is how it works. Okay, but maybe the VPN is working, because then we might see some more. So this is the dashboard, it's still kind of experimental. It's from our live system, so you see the total job bytes here. And the overview is order using Grafana. So some at least know, okay, yeah. So yeah, it really makes it easy to show what's happening here. Then here, this is not our collector, this is one of the standard graphite collectors that collects system data. This has the network traffic. And this here is disk I/O. This is nice, where you can see when first the spooling data is written. That is, I think the yellow is the write action. Yes, here you see it nice. So you first have yellow the write operations to the spooling area, and then the green is reading from the spooling area. This could also be a bottleneck if that disk is slow for some reason. But if you have got this all on one page, so you should find out what's going on. Yeah, okay, and this is pretty much like the one that we've seen on the slide before. So, and then still what's great with Grafana, you can zoom into this. So if you're interested in this particular job, then you can just mark it and jump into it and see what's going on there. So yeah, that's really useful to find out bottlenecks when examining your backup environment. Questions until here? Okay. So then next would be access control and auditing. So we already said a backup administrator with unrestricted rights has potentially access to all important data. So one general consideration is, especially in larger organizations, it might be useful to partition your backup infrastructure. So we have clients who have 3,000 or 4,000 backup clients connected to just one Bareos director. But it might get slow then when it comes to restore. The database tables get very large with millions of file name entries in it. So it may be good to think about partitioning for performance reason alone, but of course for organizational reasons and to split the risk of people getting access to data they shouldn't have. It's always a good thing to think about. Then, as I said before, we have ACLs to restrict access. And we have a feature called auditing or audit console commands. What you can do is you can define for every command that the B console can execute, you can define for all of them that it should be audited. Or you can say, okay, I'm just interested in certain commands that should be audited when issued by an administrator. So that's freely configurable. And this will be passed in the general Bareos messaging system. And the Bareos messaging system is flexible. It can write messages to syslog, to commands, directly to mail or to a file. So if you have existing auditing tools, you can simply feed it into there. So that shouldn't be a problem. Yeah, the same is more or less true for log file analysis. Again, we have the syslog connector or all the other ways. It is also true for general logs. One thing that we've done over the last couple of years, that we did a cleanup of debug messages. They weren't consistent, and that makes it easier and makes it now easier to do pattern matching using Grok or other tools, because we just sorted the way we built a debug image, debug messages. So we always have a job ID at a certain position and the client name, which makes it much easier. We have some tests made to connect Bareos to Logstash, but it's not published yet. But on the other hand, it's not that difficult. If you're used to Logstash and Grok, then the Bareos messages could be easily included in that way somehow. So then this page has some information, GitHub, the website, and so on. And the last slide, if you now find that backup is much more interested than you used to think before, it's a good thing to come to the Open Source Backup Conference in Cologne, hosted by our friends from NetWase, so you know what quality you can expect. And we would like to see you there, either as a speaker, maybe see one, or participants. Okay, so we can now come to the question section. No questions? And I can show you a little bit of the web UI. Interested? Okay. So then let's see if VPN is fast enough. So this is the latest version, which is not published. It's directly from the main developer of the web UI, who is called Frank Bergkamper. So it's on his system. It's capable to handle multiple directors where you can connect to. Then here we have already the personalized logins. That's not right. API. And what's new in this developing version is that we can now work with PO files, and there are already people that who have asked on the mailing list to make like Russian translations. So that will be the next one. So the German is ready, the Russian is almost ready, and there will also be a French version for the web interface. So then we can connect. Okay, so this is the dashboard, shows an overview of the last 24 hours, how many successful jobs waiting, there's actually something running, unsuccessful job, and then you can click on them. And here are two jobs running. So this is the name of the job, client name, the backup, full backup running. But this looks like these are notebooks. There's nothing been transmitted here, and then you can click on the job, and then you get all the log messages that belong to this job, and something will be said that client is not reachable. So interesting is the restore browser, because that is potentially addressed also to end users. Then we will remove most of it here on the left and make an reduced view for end users and an advanced view for administrators, so that they will only see what they need to see to restore some data. So here is some client has been pre-selected, and here you can then browse through the data and which is in the backup from that particular machine, and then you can either mark a whole directory or just a couple of files, click on restore, and then you can select, do you want to restore to the original location, to another client, or to another directory on the client. So that's all possible. So one point, which is also new with this version, is that you here get a list of clients. So we have 81 here, quite old ones. That is, by the way, an interesting point. This one, for example, it's a very old machine running a Bacula client version 3, so it's pretty old. And this will become then green or red here if we have the information if there are updates for this client. Yeah, and then you can browse through it and see what's happening with these clients. Okay, so. And I would say if there are still no questions, then we're done.